Greetings. 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 Greet Fred. Greet Ginger. Greet Gary. Greet Sam. Greet Helen. There's a whole lot of greetings coming up here in the last chapter of the letter to the church in Rome. Paul is finishing up. He's pretty much done with what he wants to say to the church, except for one insertion of encouragement in amongst the sea of greetings, a sea of let Harry know that I love him, or let Sarah know that she is a great person in the Lord, etc., etc., etc. I want to get to that one little glimmer of encouragement today also as we make our way through the final greetings. So today we're going to take a whirlwind trip through the chapter 16. Stay tuned to the Word. It's coming up next.
Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Yes, greetings seem to be the theme of the day, or at least the wrapping up of the letter to the Church of Rome. And that's perfectly fine. I mean, if you're writing a note to somebody, to a family member or to a group, and you want to let others know that you're interested in them, or at least you care about them, you're going to say, "Hey, one, by the way," and greet George, and let him know that I'm thinking about him, or greet Sandy, let her know that I remember her being sick a couple of months ago, and I hope she's doing well. That's what chapter 16, for the most part, is. And we're going to run through this, so I encourage you to get your Bibles ready, because we're going to be going, like I said in the introduction, a whirlwind tour through chapter 16, and then we're going to stop and dive into this wonderful glimmer of encouragement that Paul gives to the church, and he's going to give to you too, including everything that's been going on the last 3-4 days, including last night. But I digress. Let's kind of get right into it. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a servant of the church at Centuria, that you may welcome her in the Lord in a way worthy of the saints, and help her in whatever she may need from you, for she has been a patron of many and of myself as well. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who risk their necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but all the churches of the Gentiles give thanks as well. Greet also the church in their house. Greet my beloved Epaphroditus, who was the first convert to Christ in Asia. Greet Mary, who has worked hard for you. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my kinsmen and fellow prisoners. They are well known to the apostles, and they were in Christ before me. Greet Ampliatus, my beloved in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and my beloved Stachys. Greet Apelles, who is approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to the family of Aristobulus. Greet my kinsman Herodian. Greet those in the Lord who belong to the family of Narcissus. Greet those workers in the Lord, Tryphena and Tryphosa. Greet the beloved Persis, who has worked hard in the Lord. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, also his mother, who has been a mother to me as well. Greet Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermes, Patrobas, Hermas, and the brothers who are with them. Greet Philogus, Julia, Nereus, and his sister, and Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you. All right, that's the majority of the greetings. And I apologize to those who are sainted if I miss pronounce their name. It is challenging to pronounce ancient Italian names and ancient Greek names. They're not always the most fun to pronounce. All right, and now we want to get to the meat of this section. of this chapter, which is a great encouragement to us, especially in the last few days and everything leading up to. And please just be in prayer for all these election workers all over our country who have been working tirelessly to try to get everything right, to get it right and get everything counted, and everyone's voice counts, and everyone gets what they needed. And that's all I'm going to say about it. But I appeal to you, brothers, let's hear what God has to say to us today. I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that you have been taught. Avoid them. For such persons do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own appetites, and by smooth talk and flattery they deceive the hearts of the naive. For your obedience is known to all, so that I rejoice over you, but I want you to be wise as to what is good and innocent and what is evil. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. That is critical for us to understand as Christians. And I want to back up because there's a key word here that is most important for us. And it does help us to apply what's going on in our country today. And this phrase is this. It bears repeating. I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine. Not contrary to my opinions, not contrary to polls, not contrary to politicians, contrary to the doctrine that you have been taught. Meaning, look out for those who may cause divisions about the doctrines that are contained in God's word. Doctrines, teachings, things that are of God, not of man. Now, some may argue that the teachings that we hold on to, for example, some of the doctrines that we hold on to are considered to be old-fashioned and irrelevant. And I say, fine. You may think that. I don't, and I never will, because these are doctrines that come from the mouth of God. Thus saith the Lord. I cannot argue with that, will not argue with that, because I'm going to end up small and minute anyway. I am small and minute. God lifts me up and makes me whole and great. It's not about me. It's never been about me. So be wise unto salvation. Be smart about what are the doctrines of the church. Do you want to know what are the doctrines of the church? We can go over that. We can share that with you. These are, as Luther put them, when trying to instruct children in their families, six fundamental doctrines, six fundamental chief parts of what it is to be a Christian person. Do you want to know what they are? I'll tell you what they are, and that's going to lead me to create another series of episodes, another mini series on the six chief parts. Yes, I'm going to have to do that. I did open my mouth on this one, didn't I? Okay, the six chief parts. Number one, Ten Commandments. Number two, Apostles' Creed. Number three, baptism. Number three is the Lord's Prayer. Pardon me, Lord's Prayer. Number three is the Lord's Prayer. Number four is baptism. Number five is confession and absolution. And number six is the Lord's Supper, also known as Sacrament of the Altar, Holy Communion. These are the six basics, fundamental parts. There's a lot more to doctrine as well, to which I can get into, and we can talk more about that. But the fundamental keys are, do not let these out of your sight. These are the keys in which they will help you in your walk as a Christian, especially in these crazy times in which we live. So hold on to those. So I want to, so I appeal to you, brothers, go back to Romans 16:17. I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause divisions and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that you have been taught. Avoid them. For such persons do not serve our Lord Christ, but their own appetites, and by smooth talk and flattery they deceive the hearts of the naive. In other words, don't be naive. How do we end up not being naive? Naive is, let me state it this way before I go on further. Naive, fundamentally, in this context, the way he's using this word, is not about innocence. It's not about being nice and kind. That's not naive. Naive is uninformed. Do not be uninformed. Do not consider yourself something, well, all I need to know is this fundamental level. Yes, the six chief parts are fundamental. Go beyond them. Dig deeper. Don't be naive. Just don't take it on a surface thing. Listen to the words of how Luther explains them. I'll get into that when we start doing that series. The point here, the matter is, do not be naive. Do not be uninformed. Do not be somebody that just simply takes something on the surface and takes opinions from that. Dig deeper. Deeper. Be deep in your application of God's word, because you do not want to be deceived. The more you know, it's a great phrase, but the more you believe is a greater phrase. The more you believe, the more you read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest God's word. I want to take that phrase just real quick and inwardly digest. Chew it up. You know, you were told to chew your food 20 times, right? Or whatever the number. It doesn't really matter anymore. But you were told when you were a kid, when you eat your food, to chew it. And then it goes down, right? Chew on God's word. That's one of the reasons why I do these videos, quite frankly, so that you can chew on God's word. Well, if you're doing this within a group, what I just want to encourage you to do right now, chew on this, what I just talked about. Chew on the fact that do not let anybody convince you away from the true doctrine. And what do you need to do? What do you need to do in your own life to be filled with the true doctrine? What's got to happen with you and within your group? So pause the video right here. Take some time to answer that and come back. Okay, so avoid those people who are leading you away from the true doctrine. Avoid them, don't listen to them. But here's another kicker. Doesn't mean you walk away. You say, all right, look, I'm not listening to you because what you're teaching me is false. Here's the truth. Now, you may not agree with me, but I'm going to tell you the truth anyway. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you, and here's how God demonstrates his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for you. Now, do you want to mess up his doctrine? Do you want to mess up his teaching? He died for you, for crying, blooming out loud. He died for you. He gave his life for you so that you would be saved. Believe in the Lord, Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Yes, but that doesn't mean you just stay there. Don't stay there in this simpleton type way. Dive deeper. Dive deeper. Spend some time diving deeper. Anyway, so moving into verses, for such persons do not serve our Lord Christ, but their own appetites, and by smooth talk and flattery they deceive the hearts of the naive. For your obedience is known to all, so that I rejoice over you, but I want you to be wise as to what is good and innocent as to what is evil. The only way you're really going to know what is good and what is evil, what is law, what is gospel, what is truth, what is fakery. The only way you're going to know, especially in relationship to the doctrines of God, okay, especially in that realm, the only way you're going to know is by cracking open the book. The book we're working with right now. Cracking open that Bible. Let the Holy Spirit, who speaks to you through the Word, build you up so that you become as innocent, wise as serpents and as innocent as doves, so that you become faith-based, godly inspired, led, equipped person. The more you know from God, the stronger your faith is going to be. And even greater than that, and especially if y'all are doing this in groups, if you're not, do it in groups. I encourage you to take this video. If you've been watching this by yourself, that's great. That's fantastic. But what I want you to do is watch these videos with two or three people. You'd be amazed of what God can do. Not from me. No, don't be amazed from me. Because all I'm doing is opening a door. All I'm doing is giving you an opportunity to look into God's Word. Take the opportunity. Spend some time with God's Word. It's great when you do that. It's eye-opening. It's amazing when God opens your mind and your heart and your faith. So grab a couple extra people. Say, hey, look, I want us to gather together. And if you have any questions, make some comments, ask the questions. I'd be more than happy to jump in and help you with your group and your time together. So I'm going to put the address subscription. If you haven't done so, I know you've heard me say this many a time if you've already subscribed, but help your friends subscribe. Click the subscribe button. Click the bell to receive the notifications on YouTube, on Facebook. Like the video. Share it with your friends. That's one way of doing it. And then if you like the videos that I'm getting, if you haven't done so, like our Faith Huntsville Facebook page also. All right, so be an innocent as to what is evil. Verse 20, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. I want to key for on that first sentence of that verse. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. I want you to stop, pause the video for a moment, and go back and look at Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, it's going to be verse 15 and following. It's the consequences of the sin of Adam and Eve. How the enmity, the barrier, the wall between Satan and Eve's descendants. And how this barrier, I don't want to give it away too much, and how this barrier will be bitten by the serpent, but the barrier will crush his head. It's one manifestation of it right here. But you guys go back, take a look after you pause the video, maybe discuss it for a couple of moments, and then come back. All right. Then the last sentence of that verse, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Wow, that's great. That's fantastic. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, God's riches at Christ's expense. Nice acronym, right? For a word, because that's what it is. Charis, undeserved love, mercy, compassion, grace. You know, it's kind of almost hard to describe, but this is what it is. And then after that little digression. Paul continues to move forward back into his greetings. Timothy, my fellow worker, greets you. So does Lucius and Jason and Sospater, my kinsman. I, Tertius, who wrote this letter, greet you in the Lord. Tertius was his scribe, the guy who actually penned it while Paul was dictating it. Gaius, who is host to me and to the whole church, greet you. Erastus, the city treasurer, and our brother Quartus greet you. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but it's now been disclosed and through the prophetic writings have been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. Let it be so. Ta-da. To borrow a phrase, mic drop. Boom. Done. End of letter. End of teaching. And if you want to stop and talk about that last paragraph from 25 to the end of the chapter through 27, and you will hear Paul, he's just restating the exact same thing he stated from the beginning all the way now to the end about God's grace and the gospel preaching of Jesus Christ. It was kept secret for long ages, but now it is wide open. And now it has been disclosed, and through the prophetic writings, Paul doesn't consider himself a prophet. He's an apostle, a sent one. So there's the distinction of the verbiage, FYI. He's talking about the prophetic word, the Old Testament. The Old Testament is a giant prophetic word about Christ. So, pointing to, you've heard me say that before. Prophetic writings have been made known to all the nations according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. We're done. We're done with the letter to the church in Rome. Where do we go next? You know what? We've done sidebars into it, and it follows in order 1 Corinthians. So we'll kind of start there. Also, if you want to be a part of the Bible study that I'm leading on Zoom, and I'm posting the recording here on YouTube and the link to Facebook. But if you want to join in on the Minor Prophets as well, that you can watch the recording. If you're interested in being a part of that live, make a comment to me. And I'll get you the Zoom link so that you can be a part of that. That's on Wednesday nights starting at 6:30. So that's tonight starting at 6:30. So if you want to be a part of that Minor Prophets study, comment to me let me know, and I'll send you the Zoom link. All right. Taking up enough of your time this morning. You guys have a great day. I will talk to you tomorrow. Bye-bye.